The idea of faster-than-light travel is integral to modern science fiction. It was clear by the early 20th century that even the nearest other star systems were still almost indescribably distant, almost out of reach. Think for a moment about that. The current nearest star to the Sun is Proxima Centauri. It is 4.2 light-years from here. That is 9.44 trillion kilometers, or 5.88 trillion miles. That is not the closest the Sun has ever been to another star, however. We don't actually know what that number is. There have been innumerable close encounters with other star systems, and tracing them back before a certain point is impossible. But right now, distance is a problem. Not an insurmountable problem, but a problem. The realities of traveling at sublight, yet still very fast, relativistic speeds, are honestly unpalatable and costly in a number of ways. The first is that to get to relativistic speeds requires energy input. This is not impossible, but it costs, and only a few options we can currently technologically do can get us there. There are ideas, such as detonating nuclear devices behind a blast plate, to propel a spacecraft at a fraction, perhaps 10%, of the speed of light, or doing such with very light micro-spacecraft driven via laser, or even constant, though slow, acceleration. Then you need to slow back down, which takes yet more energy. But at very high relativistic speeds, over 90% of the speed of light, your enemy becomes time itself, because outside your ship, time is passing at a much greater rate than it is for you in your frame of reference. You are in the territory that Arctic explorers once were, crossing vast frozen distances apart from family and friends to reach the South Pole with what you have. And when you get back home, you cannot ever get those years back. Lost time. But in relativity, lost time is far, far worse of an issue. This is the sad reality of relativistic time dilation, a proven effect. It's been seen many times in science. And that means, yes, you can travel rapidly at a large fraction of the speed of light. The universe lets you do it. But it costs you dearly in time. Far worse than spending a few years in the Arctic. I can put this in context. In 1527, the Narvaez expedition landed in North America. A member of this expedition, Alvar Nunez Cabeza de Vaca, spent nearly 9 years walking from what is now Florida to Mexico City, with a lot of lost time away from family and friends back home in Spain. With high relativistic speeds, these intervals stretch to centuries and beyond. If you don't care that you're going to travel to the future by going really fast, then that's not so much of a cost. But if you do care about your time period, and you want to see your family and friends on Earth again, you cannot undo this one. You are forever stuck in the future if you do it, while your friends are long gone and you cannot ever go back. You would not only be light years from home, but centuries as well. But that can change. In the future, through extreme life extension and some fountain of youth, they may still be there. But that changes the game. Imagine if you could head out and expect to see most of them again. Likely not all. Or perhaps digital copies, or indistinguishable representations of them again. Maybe you could take them all with you, in digital form at least, as far as you're concerned, in your capsule traveling relativistic time. Maybe you can be convinced, perhaps technologically, that it really is them. A brave new world, indeed. Given that relativistic speeds are full of pitfalls, often science fiction simply leaves it hanging, with fictional depictions of jump drives, like Battlestar Galactica, that do not really have a basis in hard science reality. They just jump from one place to the next, with not a lot of explanation on how they actually do it. Hard science fiction, such as that of Arthur C. Clarke in his book Songs of Distant Earth, envision where the starship involved obeys the rules of the universe, and everyone goes into long-term suspended animation. Another problem entirely, for the necessarily long duration of interstellar voyages. That's more realistic, but what of going faster than light and thereby getting past some of these rather tough realities? Probably the most famous faster-than-light drive is that of Star Trek's warp drive. And while it started out as fiction, Roddenberry needed a way to get the Enterprise to other worlds fast for storytelling purposes, so he invented one. But at the time he had no basis for it. It was a unicorn technology. and of course much lore developed around it, the infamous dilithium crystals, which are a weird one in themselves. Gene was just looking for snazzy fictional drives, but here he probably should have consulted a chemist, because dilithium actually is a legitimate molecule of two lithium atoms, which does exist in nature, but you won't be exceeding the speed of light with it. With Star Trek dilithium, the story was very different. The Next Generation depicts it as element 87, which is actually francium, which is a ridiculously unstable element. Its longest-lived isotope has a half-life of 22 minutes. You would not be able to keep this stuff around for long, nor build a star drive with it either. It truly is an element that really does not want to exist. But what the fictional warp drive of Star Trek did do was spur out-of-the-box thinking by physicist Miguel Alcubierre, linked to an interview I did with Dr. Alcubierre at Event Horizon in the description below. He was quite simply watching an episode of Star Trek and wondered if, somewhere hiding within general relativity, there might actually be a way to make a kind of warp bubble as envisioned in the TV series. As it turns out, he found one that does sit within the realm of plausibility, but may never be possible in practice. But it doesn't violate the rules, at least in concept, but may not be possible in execution for two reasons. You need a lot of energy to do it, though estimates on just how much energy you need have been dropping over the years. But the real showstopper is that it requires an exotic form of matter that has negative energy density, and we don't know those materials actually exist, number one. Physics just doesn't prohibit them, but we've never seen them, though, in nature. Though we have seen something like them, there will be a future video on that. And number two, we have no idea where to even start as far as making such a material synthetically or otherwise harnessing it if we did find it. But just because we don't currently know, does not mean that there isn't a highly advanced civilization out there that has Alcubierre drives, and in some instances, they may be detectable at a distance. As an aside, detecting an Alcubierre drive under any circumstance would be an astonishing discovery. If the end result of SETI is the detection of an alien faster-than-light drive, then not only would we know that there are highly advanced aliens out there that can travel the universe instantly and without relativistic effects, it would also be a watershed of knowledge that would completely remake physics in fundamentally important ways. It's a look at the future. It would say to us, this is possible in your future if you can figure it out. Imagine that. A glimpse into the far future, an Easter egg that guides our scientific research. It would answer one of our most profound unknowns. Are we alone? But more. The answer, quite simply, would be no, we aren't alone. But no SETI message in a radio signal is needed here. You don't need a blueprint sent to us like in the movie Contact. It would be far simpler, and they may not even have cared about sending you a message when they did it. They were just using their star drive. It would simply say that it is possible in physics to travel faster than light and go most places in the universe very rapidly without the cost of time dilation. We would know that just by virtue of us seeing them do it. It also means that aliens could travel here at any moment and we wouldn't see them coming until they dropped out of warp. And here is another JMG foreshadowing of the October spooky season. The most daunting mystery here is that we have no idea how to slow down an Alcubierre drive once you get it going. The second is we really don't know what kind of accumulated radiation is going to come off that thing. Like beyond a bullet, speed of light here, when it drops out of warp. It could be enough to irradiate a planet if you aim that radiation directly at your destination and cause a mass extinction accidentally. But the aliens would know that. So in other words, any planet irradiated by an Alcubierre drive was intentionally destroyed by a faster-than-light weapon no one could possibly see coming before it hit. How the drive works in a nutshell is this. You take a spacecraft, warp space around it to create a bubble, and then send that bubble of space-time moving through the rest of space-time carrying your ship with it. Your ship is stationary in the bubble and it goes along for the ride, but crucially is not traveling at any speed inside the bubble. Thus it does not violate the universe's relativistic prohibition on faster-than-light travel for normal matter because a piece of space itself, it's sitting in, is not bound by the speed of light. Ultimately, however, everything about this grand warp drive idea is inherently dangerous. You are moving at unfathomable speed inside an extremely distorted area of space-time, a problem. And you are manipulating an enormous amount of energy. And you are dealing with exotic materials, accumulating radiation, and so on. And that seems like something that would have a lot of points of failure, and any issue would be fatal to any crew inside the starship, because the warp bubble as it failed would first contract before then moving outward, which means you'd be torn apart, not dissimilar from getting torn apart by a black hole. And because of the titanic nature of this failing warp drive, it would be detectable. As to how such a thing could be spotted, it turns out that there would be characteristic gravitational waves emitted. In a paper by Katy, Clough and colleagues, link in the description below, along with another Event Horizon interview with the authors, they detail what such a signal should be expected to look like. The first thing they were able to determine was that a warp ship, traveling at whatever full speed velocity it might have in a constant way, would not create gravitational waves. It would only produce them while accelerating or failing. Interestingly, they note that we already have a way to detect this, with LIGO, except that the instrument currently looks in the wrong frequency range of gravitational waves. So more funding would be needed to add an instrument to LIGO that can look there. That might also require higher sensitivity and better management of interference, which is an issue for LIGO, because a passing truck can throw off a measurement. But at the same time, you could use a future space-based detector and avoid that kind of interference problem completely. There would be some interesting implications here. For example, if you were to detect these signals in a kind of clustering of origin points, if that's even possible, you could infer that you're seeing a civilization entering its interstellar age and having drives failing, much like our early rockets had high failure rates. A clustering of this nature could also be a sign of an interstellar war, using the Alcubierre drive as a weapon. And in fact, it would be one of the most powerful weapons the universe allows. Not only will a collapsing warp bubble damage anything near it, it can also contain a projectile. On the other hand, the occasional random one-off detection might simply be the occasional crash that happens even with highly developed means of travel. Commercial aircraft rarely crash these days, because we have a lot of experience with the engineering of them. But that does not mean they never crash. They still do, and that works for star drives as well. That's if all of this is possible. There may be a simpler prohibition for the drive above and beyond building one and getting it going. General relativity doesn't incorporate quantum mechanics. It pays to remember here that Einstein's relativity is a description, fundamentally, that happens to predict correctly an observation. But it doesn't dip into the quantum world, which could be extremely important here. Specifically, that of a successful theory of quantum gravity, which we do not yet have, could sweep away these types of solutions to Einstein's equations. And that brings us to one major problem with Alcubierre drives. Yes, you can move through space without the problems of relativistic time dilation, but you don't get to ignore time completely. And the drive's Achilles heel here is that while it is indeed an interstellar or intergalactic starship, it also is a backwards time machine. FTL and backwards time travel are part and parcel. The very universe itself seems to hate backwards time travel. We have found few ways where it even hypothetically could be possible. But whatever the reason for that, we don't know what it is, but it may prohibit the Alcubierre drive. But if it doesn't and the drive can travel backwards in time, then the implication is extremely spooky here. That implication is that the Alcubierre drive is, in fact, a time weapon as well as a space weapon. The problem is that warp bubbles themselves, if they can be created, imply that they could also be used to create closed time-like curves, which are consistent with general relativity, and they, by nature, can be used for backwards time travel. Once again, general relativity doesn't incorporate quantum mechanics, and it may well be that anytime you try to create such a closed time-like curve, quantum effects intervene and demolish the possibility. It may be that the prohibition against backward time travel lies in quantum effects. a concept known as the chronology protection conjecture, thanks to Stephen Hawking for that one. And thus, the Alcubierre metric loophole closes just because general relativity ignores quantum mechanics. This is actually really strange how this happens. What may go on is that quantum fluctuations may build up around the region of the time machine, which would then raise the local energy density, which would destroy the system before it could travel backwards in time. That does not, however, mean that the past isn't there. In a way, it implies that it is back there somewhere, you just can't get to it. But Hawking pointed out that his idea is a conjecture. It has not been proven, and it doesn't necessarily shut down the idea of faster-than-light travel. You might conceivably still be able to do that. Just don't turn it into a time machine or your ship will explode. And that is another possibility. If we detect this happening over and over in the same place with a gravitational wave detector, it may imply that we're seeing aliens attempting and failing to go back in time. If it's true though, those aliens probably won't bother too long with it before they realize it can't ever work. But given that the conjecture is unproven, it may not be the case, and then backward time travel with an Alcubierre drive is indeed possible. Normally, we view time travel as visiting the past, creating paradoxes and the like, but it also could extend the Alcubierre weapon idea into the past. An alien species from the future could literally appear out of time and irradiate a world by pointing their radiation at it and do away with a developing civilization that, in their normal future time, was a powerful enemy, initiating a time war. Of course, the concept of alternate realities may come into play here, and you can't alter your own timeline, you just create a new one. But there is something chilling even further than this. We have never seen a time weapon of this nature, obviously, or we wouldn't be here. That could mean that none of this is possible, thus we've never been attacked. Or maybe our development and spreading out into space in the far future is innocuous and everyone likes us. Or we aren't advanced enough to bother with it yet. Or, in the future, we are extinct. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently still foreshadowing spooky season. Anna has been bean counting the candy budget. She funds no good candy. And the possum is lavishly decorating the house in a Loch Ness monster theme. Attractive in its own way, but not sure who paid for that. I think he got a hold of the debit card again. And I have placed my festive plastic pumpkin in the Event Horizon studio. It's going to be fun, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.